Sharmobile, if there was one thing you could change about the direction we are heading in, what would that one thing be?
And the biggest area of change that's required is around our welfare system. We know that many hundreds of thousands of Kiwis will lose their jobs and they will experience extreme poverty because that's what our welfare system does. We need to increase the amount of payments for our welfare system, but also to make it less conditional.
Yes, you've complained that our welfare system has been broke for 40 years or hasn't been fixed for that long. Can we afford, though, to be more generous?
I think we have to be more generous because the consequences of a welfare system such as ours is we ensure long-term poverty for those who fall into it. But long-term poverty has significant costs.
Well, you've been in huge demand by the news media. Currently, what's your benchmark when you talk about the challenges ahead? Is it the Great Depression of the 1930s?
Yeah, our understanding of this recession has changed by the week. So when we first looked at it, it was like SARS. A week later, it was the global financial crisis. A week later, it was the Great Depression. But we also learned lessons from each of those recessions. And that's why we're seeing central banks and governments around the world investing everything they can in their power to dent the recession and to drive the recovery.
And currently, there's a lot of talk about seizing the opportunity, addressing social issues, climate change, poverty, seizing the opportunity to make dramatic change. Is that wishful thinking or is it possible?
I think some change is possible because we are going to find a window of opportunity where we're all united in dealing with the health crisis, but also thinking forward in terms of what it means for our children and grandchildren, because the consequences of this recession is going to go on for many decades to come.
And it won't all be good news, that's for sure. But what's the best outcome we can hope for, say, within the next 2 years? How attractive will we be as a trading partner and destination?
New Zealand is extraordinarily well placed. We are more or less on top of this disease, but more importantly, we have shown the amount of cohesion and our ability to work together as a country. That gives us an ability to work in a coordinated fashion. We're seeing in a lot of other countries where there's a great amount of division and social unrest, and that puts us, from a political and economic perspective, a much better position.
To what extent are we in control of our own destiny? For example, the chaos happening in the US, won't what's happening there slow down our recovery?
Our recovery is not wholly within our control. There are some things we can do with our central bank and our government that will help, the things we can do as businesses and individuals. But the global backdrop is still extremely challenging. There is going to be a big global recession that will affect exports and tourism. So we're not going to go unscathed, but we are better prepared than other folk. That's because our government can do bigger bits of stimulus than anybody else. We started this recession with the second lowest government debt of any country in the OECD.
And as we try to work our way out of it, are there any lessons from the Canterbury rebuild? Any lessons about opportunities that might have been missed as a society rebuilt from the ground?
For me, there are two lessons from Canterbury. The first is sometimes state intervention can mean you create zombies. Sometimes it's better for some businesses to fail and the market to work. The other lesson for me was, you need to be super generous when it comes to looking after people. We have to prioritize the mental health and the well-being of our people because that was the biggest and ongoing cost of the earthquakes.
Shamubil, you of course coined the phrase zombie towns. Will we have to revisit that? Is there a chance that New Zealand could be plagued with zombie towns?
Weirdly, this recession is going to be more urban in its impact than regional. So in many ways, the risk is of zombie cities rather than zombie provinces, because the virus and the impact of people spending less is much more on city economies that are reliant on retail spending and services. So in many ways, the conversation doesn't change. It's about how do we make sure our economy is resilient, and how do we make sure the people who fall out of it, who are affected by it, are looked after.
Let's look now at the recent budget. It was bigger than expected, although some say there might be more to come. Can we afford, as a country, this massive program of spending?
The budget was huge, but it was fit for the times. The crisis that we face is so big that we have to be courageous and we have to be bold. I was pleased that it still had quite a lot of redundancy built in. There is still another $20 billion of potential spending that's possible over coming months and years. We need to have that headroom because we don't know how this recession will unfold and what needs our society will have. We need government to be present and we need government to be active because they've got their hand on the rudder. Nobody else can do this.
We're now facing years of deficits. Is this budget likely to be an investment for future generations or a burden for them?
It is an investment. The alternative is a much greater depression and a true depression, and the cost of the recovery becomes very long and even more scarring for generations to come. We still have to have brave conversations about what do we do with our tax system? What are the things that government does? And is our system fair? But that is a conversation for the election, not for the budget.
Let's look at infrastructure. There was another $3 billion earmarked for infrastructure on top of the, I think it was $12 billion from the so-called upgrade. Is this heading in the right direction? Are these amounts enough to get this country up and running again?
Look, when it comes to infrastructure spending, the backdrop is we have underinvested in our infrastructure since the 1980s. So there is a lot of catch up to do. What's really important is not just the amount of money we spend, but making sure those investments are the right ones. We don't want to trap New Zealand into our history. We want these investments to enable the future of New Zealand. We need to make sure that they're going to be flexible enough and they're going to be green enough that it can meet our needs of future generations, but also be consistent with a sustainable outlook for New Zealand.
And is that why the government this time has not indicated where that money will go?
Yes, I was very pleased to see that they haven't rushed into selecting projects. I would rather we did a careful analysis to make sure that the benefits outweigh the cost of the investments. We must make sure that we don't make the wrong investments in the heat of the moment.
You spoke earlier about the welfare safety net, and you've also mentioned the word quite often, taking care of the vulnerable. Just recap for us, if you could, why it's important for any country to focus on the vulnerable.
Well, in my mind, it's the sort of Gandhi quote, right? That every country is judged by how it looks after its most vulnerable. And that's because if you don't look after those folk, that's the group that continues to grow. That's where the poverty sits, and that's where you get the big social problems. New Zealand has done relatively well compared to many other places. But I think the disappointment is we've made no improvement. Income inequality in New Zealand has not improved since the 1980s.
Turning now to the economy. Now, you're in favor of a values-driven approach. What does that actually mean?
A values-driven approach is just to say, this is the overall outcome that we're trying to achieve. Something has to guide you. Why do we do stuff? What is the economy for? What purpose does it serve? And I think it's about making sure more New Zealanders are better off. If we can be very consistent in applying that test, that it is about current generations and future generations, and better off means not just those material terms, but also in non-material terms, in terms of well-being, in terms of happiness, in terms of mental health. The thing that surprises me is that for a country that is so well off, we have such big issues when it comes to things like mental health and suicide. These are real reflections of the weaknesses in our society. For poor folk, they are two related but slightly separate stories. We need to do a lot more because New Zealand is not very well housed. Our houses are not of good quality. So we've got this kind of ongoing issues in our housing system, but it reflects that underlying problem. What are we trying to achieve? If our regulation is not fit for purpose in creating healthy homes, there is something wrong with the values that drives us.
Having said that, a lot of people have made a lot of money out of selling houses to each other. What do we need to do in the future to make sure that the gap between the haves and the have-nots is closer and that as a country we're all trying to work for the same cause?
I don't have a problem with people getting wealthy, but if it has a consequence of making other people worse off, there is something wrong. And in our housing boom of the last 10, 20 years, that has been the problem, is we've seen some people get very wealthy, but we've seen the consequences in terms of people living in overcrowded homes, people living in incredible financial stress, people not being able to get access to housing, even though we know that's absolutely important for retirement in New Zealand, because otherwise New Zealand super is not sufficient. So there's all these kind of problems that are wrapped up in each other that makes untangling it really hard. So from a policy perspective, we know what the technical fixes are. That's not the problem. The problem is the willingness of the politicians across the political spectrum to deal with it.
Let's start with retirement. What now for the over 60s? Should they consider stepping aside for the betterment of the economy?
Well, for the older folk in New Zealand, I think what we'll find is ageism will be rife and they will find it very difficult to access jobs. Unfortunately, a lot of people who are older continue to work because they have to, because they need the income, because they might have lost a lot of their wealth because of falling equity prices or whatever. So I don't think it's about asking people to step aside. It's about asking, can we support people in every stage of life?
And what are your thoughts on government superannuation?
Government superannuation is setting us up for intergenerational warfare because the current system is unsustainable. It's not because New Zealand's super in and of itself is unsustainable. It's all the additional burdens that will come with it, with the accommodation supplements and the special needs and all those other things. Aging is going to be very, very costly, and that will have to be borne by young folk of the future. We can't afford to have intergenerational warfare in a population of 5 million. We can fix this stuff now. And the fix is relatively simple. We need to make sure that our welfare system, just like welfare for poor folk, is also means tested for over 60s, over 65s.
How does New Zealand look in a global context as we plan our recovery?
In my mind, New Zealand is as well placed as we can be for this recovery. We started this recession with the lowest amount of debt. We've seen the most active investment by government in the world. We've got an economy that is resilient and flexible. But most importantly, we have a population that is united. We've seen a huge amount of working together in egalitarianism in the way that we've approached the crisis. And I think that sets us up to respond to the crisis and the recovery better than many of our peers.
What excites you most about the future?
What excites me right now about the future is the opportunity that this will give us for our young folk. Despite the inferno of the recession, from the ashes will rise bright new ideas, and those will be implemented by bright young people. The more we can support that, the better the outcome and the better the future for New Zealand.
As an economist, how do you suggest we resolve some of the systemic problems that we've had in New Zealand?
Well, the systemic problems in New Zealand are long-standing, and that's a reflection of our culture and our values. We have voted and asked for this system to be like this. We have to ask for something different. We have to value something different. And the guiding principle for us should be that the economy and the government should be about making more New Zealanders better off.
Shamubil, we have in our audience a wide variety of people with all with an interest in infrastructure. Do you have a message for these business leaders, entrepreneurs, or anyone watching about what they should be thinking and doing in the next 12 to 24 months?
When we look forward to the next couple of years, I think we have three priorities. Make sure we create local jobs. Make sure we think about the future. Make sure those projects are good for our children and grandchildren. And make sure these projects are green. We can't afford to invest in the wrong things in the wrong way in this environment.
That's the long-term approach. In the short term, many of us are looking just for a trans-Tasman bubble. How significant is that if it does come off?
Australia is our closest trading partner, and many Kiwis live in Australia. It's really important we get that bubble because it will mean that there is a level of normalcy that comes back. It won't take us back to what we had pre-COVID, but certainly it will give us an ability to trade and travel and engage with each other like the cousins that we are.
We attracted enormous international attention. Many saw us as an early leader, as a brave country willing to, in the words of the Prime Minister, go early, go hard. Again, is that a feel-good factor for New Zealanders, or could that translate into future investment and trading relationships?
I think New Zealand has positioned itself really well through this crisis. We have shown that the response and the approach that we have taken is compassionate and is holistic in its approach. Very similar to what Australia has done, actually. But it does mean that we have this ability as we open up, as we do it earlier and better than other countries, that New Zealand becomes a target and a destination for investments and ideas and people. Anything that shines a spotlight on New Zealand is positive because we are a global country. We are a highly connected country. The connectivity gives us a huge amount of benefits, and I think New Zealand has shone through this period of the crisis.
Well, let's wrap up the day by finding out whether you're getting enough sleep and how happy you're feeling. This must be an incredibly interesting time for you, but how are you feeling?
It's like the Chinese proverb, right? May you live in interesting times. And unfortunately, we're living through the most stressful and most interesting of times, at least for an economist. I think we're blessed in that we're able to understand and try and help shape the responses that we have. The way we will be judged, this generation and the people who are in the media, in the expert positions and the positions of leadership, we will be judged by our actions and our contributions. My goal is to be present, to offer the best that I can. And I hope it means that we're making good decisions and we're holding scrutiny up to bad decisions.